Hey, bro. Hit my intro.
What's happening, my visionaries? It's your man, J Rock. Back in effect. I'm live and direct, and I'm coming at your neck with yet another. Video, baby. Ah. The video, man, as always, just like, subscribe if you want to. If you don't, then just do it if you want to do it, because Jesus said this is the right thing to do. What's happening, my visionaries? It's your man, Jay Ron. Back up in this thing with yet another video, man. You know? About to check out for the first time, Mad Season. Wake up. It's the first of the month. Shout out to Bone Thugs and Harmony. So we got Mad Season. Now, since I started doing Alice in Chains reactions, a lot of people have been saying, man, you got to react to Mad Season, man. Nobody really does Mad Season. Y'all wrong. I done seen a lot of people do Mad Season. But yeah, so I know Mad Season got Lane in it from Alice in Chains. But let's see who else is in the band. Let's do some research. Mad Season, okay, this is according to Wikipedia, a reliable source. Mad Season was an American rock supergroup formed in 1994 as a side project of members of other bands in the Seattle grunge scene. Did somebody tell me that Alice in Chains wasn't from Seattle? I think somebody told me that. Y'all was lying, because unless I'm tripping, it says Seattle grunge scene. So I don't know if somebody, I think that might have been another band that I may have gotten mistaken for grunge. But I think somebody said somebody in this band wasn't from, maybe not everybody in the band is from Seattle. Maybe that's what he was saying. The band's principal members included guitarist Mike McCready of Pearl Jam. So we got Pearl Jam up in the building. Singer Lane Staley of Alice in Chains. We got Alice in Chains AIC up in the building. And drummer Barrett Martin of Screaming Trees. Never heard of that band. I have to check them out. And bassist John Baker Saunders, who just, I guess, ain't in nobody's band. The band went on a semi-permanent hiatus in 1986 due to band members' conflicting schedules and Staley's problem of substance abuse. God bless his soul. Attempts were made in the late 1990s to revive the group without Staley, and material for follow-up release to Above had been worked on. However, the band dissolved following the death of bassist John Baker Saunders in 1999, which is the year that I was born. God bless his soul, man. That's crazy. And then also Lane also unfortunately died of a drug overdose 3 years later. So this band was kind of a once in a lifetime thing. They did have a reunion in 2012 and 2014 and 15 with both Martin and McCready. But like my man No Life Shaq say, that's tough. All right, well, enough of all that sentimental stuff and all that sad existential shit. Mad Season, wake up. Let me put on my headphones, the truth, bam, and we gonna do what it do. Mad Season, wake up. Let's do it. It's always interesting when songs start out with the bass first. Y'all gonna hate me, but I'm sampling this. Ooh, the vibraphone? They got Roy Ayers on this? Oh, I like the chorus pedal on the guitar. I know how much I like rim shots.
Your love affair has got to go. south, no way to go.
I already like where the song was going. Crescendo. Like this been played with a Fender Stratocaster. I know that's what is using a lot of Pearl Jam songs. So I gotta say, hot damn, this is spicy, man. I'm already feeling this. Yeah, I love the slow burning. Really, really methodical playing from the instrumentation. I love how it's building up on that emotion. And, you know, had that little small crescendo and then brought it back down. Like, I'm really loving the arrangement on this, man. And Lane singing sounds really good. Very, very, very emotional. Let's get back into it, though.
The crash.
Licks, man. Drums and the bass, man. Shout out to the bassist. Rest in peace. Bam. Harmonies right there.
Wake up, wake up, wake up.
Mmm. That's playlist right there. That is a bop. Man, what a song, man. Man, Lane's voice is so harrowing, so haunting, so raw, so real. It's genuine. You know, it's not. He's not focused on trying to be the most technical singer or trying to sing. I mean, he's really expressing himself when he sings. Like, it's... And that's what's synonymous with, you know, the grunt sound. I mean, these guys, they weren't the most technical singers. They weren't the greatest singers, weren't the greatest vocalists. But they could really make you feel whatever emotion that it was that they were trying to convey. And I get this sense, this song has got a sense of just almost pleading, like, wake up. You know what I mean? And I feel this song could be about his addiction to heroin. I know sometimes, a lot of times, people, when they sing songs about drug addiction, they use metaphors of, you know, anthropomorphic qualities to the drugs, making them have human behaviors. Like, you know, a guy could be singing about a woman, but it could be, you know, about drugs, about something else that he may be addicted to. So they give these, you know, these qualities to this, and it makes it a more, even more emotional, because, you know, you may be, initially you may perceive it to be about love, about this, but it's really about trying to overcome that. So it starts out with, wake up, young man, it's time to wake up. So maybe this is himself telling, maybe this is a song, this is a song of him singing to himself. Your love affair has got to go for 10 long years. So perhaps he's been addicted for 10 long years. For 10 long years, the leaves to rake up. So to me, that just, I interpret that as, okay, if I got a pile of leaves in my yard, man, it's like, I don't feel like it, but I got to rake them up. It's a lot of work. But it's something that I feel that I need to do to cleanse my yard. So this could be a metaphor, like, okay, the leaves to rake, for 10 long years, the leaves to rake up, the mess to clean up. Slow suicides, no way to go. So killing yourself slowly, that's no way, that's no way to go. It's not easy to kill yourself, but as it's even more difficult to continue living on and moving forward and traversing the path that's in front of you and saying, it is, I accept it, and I'm gonna beat it. That determination, that persistence is what'll keep you going forward. Verse 2 is, blue clouded gray, you're not a crack up, dizzy and weakened by the haze, moving onward, so an infection, not a phase. So blue clouded gray, you're not a crack up. I mean, blue clouded gray, that could be like him analogizing his mind, perhaps, says you're not a crack up. I'm maybe saying it's not, you know, it's not all this cracked up to be. Dizzy and weakened by the haze. So he's dizzy from the smoke and the cloud, or dizzy from that, excuse me, not the smoke and the cloud, but dizzy from the haze of being, you know, under the influence of being, you know, in that moment. Moving onward. So, you know, he's in that haze, but he's like, I'm just moving on. I just want to move on. So an infection, not a phase. So he's saying maybe people were like, you know, maybe he was thinking to himself, like, maybe this is just going to be a phase. Maybe this will be nothing. I'll do it once or twice and I'll be done with it. But what started out as just a phase became an infection. What started out as a simple scratch became a scar. Something that you just can't quite get rid of. Verse 3, the cracks and lines from where you gave up, they make an easy man to read. So the cracks and lines from where you gave up. So you've got all these markings, these the evidence of your continuous battle and your loss, your losses. Make an easy man to read. They make it easy to read when you say that you're gonna stop. But the scars, the markings, the evidence shows you that that's not the case. It makes you easier. So when somebody says I'm gonna quit, and you know they won't, you see what they're doing to themselves. For all the times you let them bleed you, for all the little peace from God you plead and beg, for a little peace from God you plead. So for all the times that you let them bleed you, so maybe this is like his way of trying to conceptualize, like, look, this is for all the pain that people have caused you, from letting them take advantage of you and completely run you to the point of dilapidated. So maybe this is him trying to conceptualize that. He said, I just want a little piece of just a little piece from God, pleading and begging, and reiterates that line to really, really emphasize how it feels. And it goes back to verse 1. The bridge is, wake up, young man, wake up, wake up. So he's telling himself, man, wake up. You got to get out of this. Wake up, young man, it's time to wake up. Your love affair has got to go. For 10 long years. It's saying this love that you have for this particular thing that's causing you harm, that's causing you pain, more pain than anything else was, it's got to go. For 10 long years, the leaves to rake up, the mess you got to clean up, slow suicides, no way to go. Slow suicides, no way to go. Killing yourself slowly is no way to go. Man, this was a very, very powerful song right here. This is a very, very poignant song. And the profundities of it, I can't even wax poetic about it too much. I can't even really articulate the emotions behind it. You know, on my We Die Young video where I reacted to Alice in Chains' We Die Young, and on my other videos where I talk about drug addiction and stuff, and I received some flack about it from people who explained to me their opinions and their stance on these sorts of things. And my stance and my ideologies got misconstrued because perhaps the way that I said it, I have a tendency of saying shit, which I really try to work on a lot, but I have a tendency of just saying shit sometimes, and I think I'm saying the right thing, but when I articulate and I hear myself back, I'm like, okay, that wasn't my intended, the way that I intended it to be, to the way I intended it to, you know, to say it. Now if I say what I mean, I say what I mean and I mean what I say, but I might not have said it in the way that I wanted to say it or how I wanted it to come off, but at the end, once I say it, okay, you can feel however you want to feel. I have no problem with that, man. People have their opinions. People have their ideologies. I could, honestly, man, you're going to think what you think, and I'm going to think what I'm thinking. So my consistent position has always been this. I don't judge people who are addicted to drugs. I don't say that they are weak or anything of that nature, but I will say this. Addiction is not a choice, but to take the drugs is a choice. And that's something that people don't seem to understand from my point of view. I'm not saying that drug addiction. The addiction itself is it's just something that you can just wake up one day and say, you know what, I'm gonna stop being addicted to this. I understand that it's a disease. It's internalized, you know what I'm saying? But how can you have the addiction without taking the drug? Whether you're trying to deal or cope with some kind of pain, addiction would not exist if there was no substance to be addicted to. And that is my point. It's not that the person who's not that the addiction itself or the person that's addicted is at fault, but taking the drug that led to the addiction, that is, you have to take personal responsibility on that. And I'm not saying that drug, it's different per basis. I don't presume to know every fucking drug dealer's mentality in the world. I mean, not drug dealers, excuse me. Drug user, addicted, you know, substance abuser mentality. I don't know what the fuck they think all the time, all of them in the world. Nobody knows. CDC, I mean, nobody knows, man. Nobody knows. There's no statistic to judge everybody because nobody thinks the same. So before I see all the comments down here that say, well, you're just a fucking judge. It's cool. You can say that. But first, listen. Don't just hear. Listen, because they're two totally different things. Listen to what I'm saying first. And then after you listen and you take heed and you listen to what I say and you just sit down and you say, you know what? Fuck this dude. I don't agree. Cool. I'm fine with that. But I'm going to reiterate again, I'm not saying that addiction is a choice, but I am saying that taking the drug that led to the addiction is a choice. Unless somebody put a gun to your head and said, motherfucker, take that shit or I'm going to blow your fucking head off, it is a choice. Not the addiction. That came after. But taking the drug preceded that. So if there is no drug, what is the addiction? But then people are going to say, well, what? Some people just have addictive personalities. I'm sorry. I take accountability for everything that I do in my life. I don't blame nobody for shit that happens to me. I don't blame God. I don't blame some unforeseen, nothing. I say, you know what? I have free will to do whatever I want to do. I made this choice. It led to this. There's a cause and effect to everything in life. That's the duality of existence. With every action, there's a reaction. Newton's third law of motion. With every action, there's an equal or opposite reaction. There's going to be something that happens. Because I did this, now this has happened. So again, now if you're somebody who's abusing or who has abused drugs and you came out of it, God bless you. You should talk to more people about your experience and how you dealt with that. It could help somebody else. I did drugs at a certain point, but I didn't do anything that could get me addicted to something. I'm not a person who has, I'm addicted to other shit. Like, I'm addicted to watching boxing. I'm addicted to, like, fucking, I was addicted to hot chips. I'm trying to break that shit. You talking all this shit? You addicted to hot chips, nigga? I was addicted to hot chips, bro. I'm still fighting it. I'm having withdrawals every day. Trust and believe. But as silly as that is, I mean, addiction is real. I understand. I get it. It's real. It is not a choice. But the strength to fight it off is valiant, man. It takes a lot. I get it. It takes a lot. It's not easy. This video is almost 30 fucking minutes. I'm finna stop talking. But my comments do not, it just, every time I bring this, I don't want to keep bringing this up every time I do a song that revolves Lane. But I just hate, I really hate what drugs do to people, and I hate how much talent it kills and takes from us, because it's taken a lot. It's taken a lot. Drugs have killed, or either killed physically or completely deteriorated the person to the point to where they might as well be dead, because they're zombies. So I'm not mad at the person that's addicted to drugs. I'm mad at the drugs themselves. I'm mad at the people that sell those kind of drugs. I don't think weed is a drug. I just don't. ain't never seen a motherfucker like, goddamn, nigga, I need that blunt. I need that blunt. I need that blunt. I just ain't seen it. Now, I seen somebody that smoke too much, but them niggas just lazy. But I'm talking about the hard shit, heroin, crack, cocaine. I'm going to get fucking, don't take this video down, YouTube. I'm using it as an example. It's educational. Heroin, crack, cocaine, fentanyl, all the shit that's synthetic, that's chemical. Some of the weed is chemical, which is why you can't smoke everybody's shit, because people lace their shit with other shit. That kind of stuff, I despise it. I will always despise it because it just kills. It's killed so many people. It's killed and ruined so many people's lives. And anything that does that is inherently fucking evil. Not the people. Don't misconstrue what I'm saying, because if you do, then that's just on your ass and you're just looking for something to fucking bitch about. But not the people are evil, but the drugs themselves, but the people that sell it. And no, this shit kill motherfuckers. Okay, yeah, you a piece of shit. I've never been one of the people that be like, look, man, make your money. No, motherfucker, you killing people. Now, there's a flip there's a flip to that argument. He just supplying to a demand, the basic fabric of our economy. There's a supply and a demand. Boom, 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 boom. So how is he wrong? Well, you're wrong because you're pushing some, you're peddling something that's fucking harmful to people. That's why you're wrong. But that's what happens when money is the entire basis of your life. You completely abandon all morality and principles. Rest in peace, Lane. Rest in peace, everybody that's died from drugs, because it's a fucking shame. There's no telling how much music we would have, how many things we would have if people didn't do drugs, hard drugs. Now, weed and acid and all that kind of stuff. Now, here's the thing. I don't think you should do everything just because I don't think it's harmful. I don't know. I'm not a scientist. I'm not a fucking doctor. I don't have the kind of clinical knowledge or understanding or awareness to the finer details to say, okay, you can do this and you can't do that. Judging from my own anecdotal experience, from what I did, from, you know what I'm saying, the stuff that I've done, psychedelics and weed is not that bad. Psychedelics may be a little bad. If you're a person who got like a fucking, any kind of psychological disorder, do not do no fucking psychedelics. It's going to fuck you up worse. It's either going to make you better or fuck you up worse. Ain't no in between. And you don't want to take that chance. That's on you if you do. But weed, nah. Mm-mm. Depending on what kind of weed. Now, you know what I'm saying? Like I said, you can't just trust everybody's shit. You know what I'm saying? Because you know, anyway, this video long as hell. I'm about to get the fuck up out of here. This video way too long. Visionaries, I salute to you. Remember, I always say best, never stress. Remember, I always do your very best. Live, love, love life. Because why? Life is beautiful. That's why. And we'll catch you on the flip side. If you are somebody who addicted to drugs, man, go get help, man. Please go get help. Not for anybody else, but for yourself, man. Go get help. Call someone. Talk to someone. There's hotlines. Whatever you got to do to get yourself into a better position in your life, call somebody for help. It's never too late. It's only too late when you want it to be. Remember that. All right, y'all. I'm up out of here, man. Deuces.
Hold a cold one like he hold an old gun, like he hold a microphone and stole the show for fun, or a foe for ransom. Flows is handsome, holes in tandem, anthem, random, tantrum, phantom of the grand old Opry. Ask the dumb hottie, mask, pump shoddy, somebody stop me. Hardly come sloppy on a retarded hard copy. After rocking parties, he departed in a jalopy. Watch the drop top poppy, known as the grimy, limey, slimy, try me, blimey. Simply smashing in a fashion that's timely. Mad villain dashing in a beat rhyme crime spree. We rock the house like rock and roll. Got more soul than a sock with a hole. Set the stage with a goal to have the game locked in a cage, getting shocked with a pole. Overthrow it like throwing over a biscuit. A lot of bitches think he's overly chauvinistic. Let go his dick if that's the case. Rats, what a waste. There's more cats to chase. Dogs, he got it like new powers. Woke up broke and spit the shit in a few hours. Sheesh, been a leash since the Glee Club. Had your fans saying, please make me a dub. Well, since you asked kindly, where he been behind the mask? Who can't find me? You're blind in the wine zone. Leave your mind blown when he shine with the nine. He's a rhinestone. Cowboy.